Welcome to First Church.
Good morning. Welcome to First Church. It's nice to be together, even though we're apart.
Welcome to First Church.
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 Welcome to First Church, and peace be with you.
Welcome to First Church. Thank you for coming.
Hope to see you soon.
Good morning. Welcome to church.
Welcome to First Church.
Welcome to First Church. Welcome. We're so glad that you are here.
As Abraham welcomed the strangers, so God welcomes us.
God greets us with joy and says, "Rest here for a while."
God brings out water to wash our dusty feet.
God prepares a meal to nourish our weary spirits.
So let us receive the gracious hospitality of our God.
Let us rest in this holy place where there is shade and water, food and laughter.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, the Holy Spirit, whose perfect justice we long to see, you are the restless breath of love that sweeps through the world. You move where you will, breaking down barriers, upsetting evil systems of oppression, stirring hearts to change, making all things possible. Plant faith deep within us and inspire us to hunger and thirst for justice. Come, Spirit of God. Sweep through our world, bringing great change. May the bounty of your goodness be shared more justly, so all may share in the rich blessings of your creation. And in this time of worship, transform our minds so that we may act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, not just today, but all the days of our lives, through Jesus, who saves us and leads us on. Amen.
Sun, moon, and stars.
A reading from the first book, from the book of Genesis, beginning in chapter 18. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, and as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day, he looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly three measures of choice flour and knead it and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife, Sarah?" And he said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife, Sarah, shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh." She was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said. And the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. "Now," Sarah said, "God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me." And she said, "Who would ever have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." May God add a blessing to the hearing of this holy word.
Catch-a-nation, guffaw, cackle, chortle, bray, titter, howl, snort, hee-haw. These are just some of the words I found this week when I searched online for types of laughs. My favorite was Cachin Nation, mostly because I've never heard of that one before. It means loud, convulsive laugh, and I am guilty of that sometimes. I looked up the word laugh and the kinds of laughter because the word laughter or laugh appears 6 times in the lesson that was just read for us today by Pastor Allison. And each mention of that word relays a different emotional context, from derision to disbelief to unfettered joy. So what was all the laughter about? Well, before we get there, we have to set the stage. This is a very long story, and we've missed the first part. You might remember that God spoke to Abraham, then named Abram, when he was already an old man, and told him and his wife Sarah, then named Sarai, to go to a land they had never heard of before in order to found a great nation from their own offspring. It was an outlandish idea, an outlandish promise, not only to go to a foreign land they'd never heard of before, but there to have babies who would populate the land, because Sarah and Abraham were already at that time long in the tooth, and Sarah had never been able to have children. But this voice Abraham heard was compelling, and so they moved, living as nomads in a foreign land. Years passed after they moved, and still no children. Just when Abraham began to despair, God spoke to him again. "Look toward the heavens," God said. "Count the stars if you are able to count them. So shall your descendants be." And so they waited, and they waited, and they waited, and more years passed, but the promise was still not fulfilled. One day, Sarah, being more practical than Abraham, decided that enough was enough. So she called her husband aside and suggested incredulously that Abraham have a child with her slave, Hagar. Now, Abraham, being a man, did not need much convincing. And Hagar conceived and gave birth to a little boy named Ishmael, whom tradition says is the ancestor of all of the Arab people. So at last, Abraham did have a son at the ripe old age of 86. But remember that this promise was not just made to Abraham, it was made to Abraham and Sarah, and Sarah's promise was not yet fulfilled. It was at this point in the story that God changed both of their names, Abram to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah, meaning princess. Sarah means princess. And that name change is significant because it is the only time in all of recorded scripture that a woman's name is changed because of an act of God. And at that point, this story really becomes more about Sarah. And at this point, we now arrive at today's events. One day, 3 strangers appeared at the entrance of Abraham and Sarah's tent. They lived in a tent because they were Bedouins, nomads. But these were not just any visitors, we are told. Instead, this was a theophany, which is a big seminary word simply meaning the appearance of the deity to humans. And isn't it interesting that God appears to Abraham as 3 humans? So Abraham did as anybody in that culture would have done to show extravagant hospitality to strangers, which for them was not extravagant at all. It was simply hospitality. He bowed down low to the ground to these strangers. He called them his Lord. He brought them water to wash and asked them to sit in the shade of a tree to rest. He told Sarah to make some fresh bread, and he ordered a servant to slaughter a calf so that a feast could be prepared. Over the meal, with a mouthful of veal, one of the strangers asked, "Where is Sarah?" "She's in the tent," Abraham replied. "Why do you want to know?" And I imagine that the stranger smiled and replied, "Because your wife, Sarah, is going to have a son." Now Sarah, who was not allowed to mingle with the men in that patriarchal culture, was listening to all of this just inside the entrance of the tent. And when she heard the same tired old promise about a long promised but never arriving baby from a stranger, no less, she laughed. "Oh, that's rich," she murmured. "I'm old. I'm so old, and my husband is older still, and quite frankly, I'm just not that interested anymore." "Why is she laughing?" the stranger wanted to know. And then the stranger asked Abraham the question that God continues to ask every generation of believers who cling to the promises of God despite all of the evidence to the contrary. He asked, "Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?" Well, old Sarah was embarrassed by all of this, and so she did what I do sometimes, or maybe what you do sometimes when we get caught. She lied. "I did not laugh," she said. "Sure you did," said the stranger. So after years of waiting, after years of promises, after disappointment and heartache and longing and frustration and anger, Sarah finally became pregnant at the age of 90. And she gave birth to a son and named him Isaac, which in Hebrew means "he laughs." This story ends with Sarah's marvelous words. She said, "God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me." And this woman, who had been the brunt of jokes her entire married life because she could not have a child, had the last laugh. This is a deeply, deeply human story for all kinds of reasons. Not the least of which is because that we too use laughter, all kinds of laughter, to mask our pain. We use laughter to keep people away from the truth we try to hide, to keep them away from those things that really matter to us. And this is a deeply spiritual story for any of us who try to follow after God, because we all know what it's like to wait on a God who never, ever seems to be in a hurry. And yet, like our father Abraham and like our mother Sarah, we cling to these promises. We cling to our hopes and dreams for a better world, even when all of that seems laughable. Week after week after week, month after month, year after year, we come to worship and we bring with us our troubles and the troubles of the world. And week after week, month after month, year after year, we read and hear and proclaim the promises of God for this world. We have the audacity to pray all of the time, "Your kingdom come, Your will be done on this earth now as it is in heaven. And we keep doing that week after week, month after month, year after year. We keep doing that. Even as the coronavirus has no vaccine, even though lots of folks are out of work, even though this planet continues to convulse because of human greed and arrogance, even though despots continue to reign, even though the poor get poorer and more marginalized, even though institutional racism still destroys lives and smashes dreams and feeds rage, even though all lives do not matter equally. That's the reality. And when I'm having a really bad day, when I'm reading too much of the news, when too much of this is swirling around my head, I think of all of the troubles of the world. And all of those pesky promises of God. And sometimes I snort with derision. It's a bitter laugh. And I wonder if I'm not the biggest fool of all. But when I pause and breathe, when I pray, when I stop, when I listen, when I pause and act some sort of movement in this world, I realize what all of that derision and cynicism actually is. It's a defense. It is based on my very short view of history, based on my very short lifespan. But the challenge of the Christian faith has always been to take a very, very long view of history, far longer than any of us will live, and to exercise, based on the promises of God, a rigorous faith in God, a God who is involved in human events. Didn't Jesus show us that? The extent to which God would go to involve God's self in human events. I've come to believe that most Christians, myself included, usually practice something called functional deism. Functional deism never ever denies the existence of God, but it also never ever expects God to act decisively in human affairs. Functional deism is safe and makes sense, except that our faith is not about making sense. Faith is about naming human longing and then trusting God to bring those longings to pass. It's about hope for all of those things that seem too good to be true. And hasn't it seemed too good to be true that millions of people around the world are awaking to a new and deeper realization about the sin of systemic racism and oppression? Isn't it marvelous, marvelous, that our young people are leading us toward a more just world, something we Christians call the kingdom of God? Now, you can be cynical about that if you wish. You can say that this moment will pass and nothing will come of it. Or you can stifle your laughter and open yourself to hope. Open yourself to the marvelous promise made to the people of God in every age that absolutely nothing, nothing shall be too wonderful for the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Life-giving, life-restoring, life-fulfilling God, we give you thanks this day for all that you created good. You formed us out of dust, shaped us in your image, called us by your Spirit, redeemed us by your grace. When we least expect it, you surprise us with your presence. When hope eludes us, you do wondrous things in our lives. And your promises unfold in unexpected ways. And like Abraham and Sarah, we are left in wonder and amazement and holy laughter. Gracious God, as you were present with your servants in the desert, we bring to you the hurting of our world. Be present with us, with the ones we love, with the ones invisible to us, with all who are in pain this day, all who are in need of healing in body, mind, or spirit. Speak to the places of our deepest pain, places of our deepest longing. Long before your promises were fulfilled, O God, you asked Abraham and Sarah to make their home among foreigners and share the blessing that was to come. And now, O God, you ask the same faith of us, the faith to count ourselves among the least, to find our place alongside the poor and broken, the faith to trust in your mercy and your promises and to share what we have received, the faith to wait expectantly for your reign of justice and equity, and the faith to work together with those who most need its gifts. And so we pray for your uniting spirit to work in us and to reveal the layers of artificial divisions and false loyalties that we so wrongly place upon your beautiful creation, so rich in its diversity. We pray for your spirit of peace. We pray for your spirit of encouragement. In these unfolding times, make us faithful stewards of the gospel. Empower us to be your hands and feet. Move us to answer the cry of our neighbor, to draw the circle of your welcome and offer holy hospitality. Lead us in shaping our lives to reflect your kingdom. And in some small way, may our faith and our sharing help to bring your promises into being in our world. Hear our prayers, gracious God, for our needs this day. And hear us as we join our many voices together, our voices far and wide, in the prayer of Jesus, as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
What do you think the answer is to the question, is anything too wonderful for the Lord? Would you open yourselves this week in your relationships with yourself to that kind of hope that makes you laugh in spite of the troubles of the world? And may your faith grow and your love and your hope until that day that God's reign does come on this earth just as it is in heaven. Go in peace. Amen.